William Morrow and Harper Audio present N-4 Down, The Hunt for the Arctic Airship Italia, by Mark Piesing, read by Matt Jamie. Introduction. Once upon a time in the north. The book smelled old. It must have been sitting on the shelves of the second-hand bookstore for a long time before I bought it. The title was enigmatic, With the Italia to the North Pole. What was the Italia? And who was going to the North Pole? The author was just as mysterious. Who was Umberto Nobile? I was looking for a mystery to solve, and now I had found one. When I opened the stiff pages of the 90-year-old volume to try to find the answers, I felt a slight draft on my hand. An equally old and irregularly cut-out newspaper clipping slipped out of the book and fluttered to the floor. The faded headline of the story answered some of my questions. It read, Bound for the North Pole, Italian's Big Adventure, First Day's Thrilling Experiences. The story was bylined London, April 16, 1928. As I fumbled with the book, an old map unfolded itself from the back cover to offer another clue. Svalbard, it was titled. Suddenly, I could hear the throb of Zeppelin engines in my ears. Svalbard is a tiny group of dots in the middle of the Arctic Ocean. In Philip Pullman's His Dark Materials trilogy, Svalbard is described to Lyra, the heroine of the books, as the farthest, coldest, darkest regions of the wild. It is a land of slow-crawling glaciers, of the rock and ice floes where the bright-tusked walruses lay in groups of 100 or more, of the seas teeming with seals, of the great grim iron-bound coast, the cliffs 1,000 feet and more high, where the foul cliff ghasts perched and swooped, the coal pits and fire mines where the bearsmiths hammered out mighty sheets of iron and riveted them into armour. It was on Svalbard, I now knew, that I would find answers to my last questions. I caught a Boeing from London via Oslo to Longyearbyen, the capital of these remote islands. The 2.5-hour flight time in a modern airliner did make the ends of the earth seem closer. As we dragged our bags across the tarmac to the lonely airport terminal building, the icy wind from the North Pole that cut through our down jackets, as if we weren't even wearing them, was a healthy reminder of where we actually were. If that didn't make us realize how far north we had traveled, on three sides of the tarmac strip were mountains covered in snow, their glaciers glinting fiendishly in the April sunlight. At the end of the runway lay the cold, grey and deadly waters of the Arctic Ocean itself. Jutting out of the mountainside above the airport was the grey rectangular entrance to what appeared to be a nuclear bunker. My guess was not far off. It was the Svalbard Global Seed Vault, a long-term seed storage facility built to stand the test of time and the challenges of natural or man-made disasters. The seed vault is the world's guarantee of crop diversity in the future. Whether any survivors of our civilization would be able to reach it is a question we will hopefully never have to answer. On the drive into town, it felt like we could slip into Lyra's Svalbard at any time. The mountain sides above the town are covered by the remains of aerial ropeways that once took coal from mines to the harbour. The mine entrances themselves, which are little more than large holes in the side of the mountain, and a handful of forbidding, abandoned factories rumoured to host raves. The grim wooden hostels were now bunk rooms for hikers, and the dingy bars they frequented looked as if they'd seen their fair share of fights. The supermarkets warned customers not to bring their guns into the store. I had my picture taken, quickly, by the sign with a polar bear inside a big red triangle on the edge of town. Underneath were the words, Gjelder hele Svalbard, meaning, applies to all of Svalbard. Down by the quayside, past where the scientists monitoring the melting permafrost park their half-tracks, is a small black wooden shack with a sizable wooden cutout of a polar bear looking straight at you. On the front are the words North Pole Expedition Museum. Right next to that label is a picture of a zeppelin. Airships had once flown over Svalbard. Entering the shack is like stepping into a fantasy world. With its faded cuttings, black and white pictures, typed notes, and shaky newsreel footage, the museum tells the story of the aeronauts who once upon a time explored the unknown lands of the North Pole by hot air balloon, airship, and primitive airplane. There is a section about Swedish hero Salomon August André, who decided he would try to fly from Svalbard to the North Pole in a balloon. On July 11, 1897, he and his two crewmen took off for the pole, floated over the horizon, and disappeared. It would be another 33 years before their skeletons were found. Another section of the museum is dedicated to the not-so-derring-do of journalist and all-round chancer Walter Wellman. He attempted three times, in 1906, 1907, and 1909, to fly to the North Pole in a sausage-like airship called the America. In 1909, the America managed to stay in the air for a couple of hours before it crashed. Despite this further setback, Wellman was determined to return the following year with a larger airship, but he never did. His dream of flying to the North Pole died when he heard of Dr. Frederick Cook's claim to have reached the pole on foot. Instead, the following year, he decided to fly across the Atlantic in the America, an endeavour that met with as much success as his polar flights. In truth, the exhibition is really about one man and one type of machine. Umberto Nobile and airships. Prodigy, dirigible engineer, aeronaut, Arctic explorer, member of the fascist party, opponent of Mussolini, maybe even Soviet spy, and always accompanied by his dog, Titina. Nobile twice flew jumbo jet-size airships, lighter than aircraft that he designed and built, on the epic journey from Rome to Svalbard to explore the Arctic. The N-4 Italia was the second of these flying machines. In 1926, a dirigible he built and piloted, the Norge, became the first aircraft to cross the roof of the world from Norway to Alaska. It may even have been the first aircraft to reach the North Pole. His public falling out with his famous co-leader, Roald Amundsen, over who should take credit for the flight, made headlines across the United States. Headlines that were perhaps matched only by the news that when Nobile was invited to Washington, Titina, who had flown over the North Pole with him, had relieved herself on the carpet of the White House itself. In 1928, he ignored all the omens and all his enemies to return again to the North Pole in the Italia, but he never did become the first man to land at the pole from an airship. The crash of his vessel out there on the pack ice made front-page news around the world. The disappearance of many of his men was a mystery that has never been solved, with rumours of cannibalism never fully disproved. His treatment at the hands of Mussolini when he eventually returned to Rome was compared by his supporters to that of Alfred Dreyfus by the French government at the end of the 19th century. This book, then, is the story of Nobile, his friends and enemies, their expeditions, and the airships and airplanes they flew. Of the end of the golden age of polar exploration, that era when the pilot replaced the tough man of Arctic exploration in the public imagination, and when the Zeppelin and the airplane battled it out in the Arctic skies for the future of aviation, a time when some countries even considered banning aviation altogether because it was so dangerous. It is the story of some of the women, such as millionaire Louise Boyd, who up till now have been written out of the tale. It is a story that incorporates the rise of fascism and the struggle against it. It is also the story of a moment in time when many people thought there was a lost continent hidden at the North Pole behind the ice and fog. Today in Bedford, United Kingdom, in Paris, in California, and in Jingmen, China, a new generation of airship engineer, pilot, and dreamer is looking to explore the Arctic skies once more. In King's Bay, hundreds of miles to the north of Longyearbyen, a huge metal mooring mast was erected to secure Umberto Nobile's airships. It stands there waiting, still, for the explorers and their airships to return again. Prologue. The Arctic Ocean, May 25, 1928.
"We are heavy!"
the crewman shouted as the giant airship dropped through the fog toward the sea ice below. It was as if Thor himself were hurling the Italia out of the sky. Perhaps the great explorer Roald Amundsen was right, thought General Umberto Nobile, leader of the expedition. The Italians were a half-tropical breed who did not belong in the Arctic. It was 54 hours since Nobile had left King's Bay on Svalbard in the Arctic Circle to fly to the North Pole. It was at least 72 hours since he had last slept. For 2 days and nights, Nobile's crew of 16 men and his cherished Titina had battled high winds, fog, snow and ice in the airship he had designed and built to explore the roof of the world. The lack of sunlight, the howl of the wind, and the tremendous cold turned them into sullen automatons who struggled to keep the dirigible in the air. The heavy woolen clothes they wore lent them little warmth. The N-4 Italia had reached the North Pole early on the morning of May 24, 1928, and the high spirits they had enjoyed when they had lifted off from the mining settlement of King's Bay had briefly returned when the men cried out, "We're there!" For 2 hours, the suspense built as the dirigible circled the North Pole, while it slowly descended through the clouds until the pack ice was visible. There was a moment of disappointment when the crew could not land a party on the ice because the wind was too strong for the sky anchor to hold the airship steady. Nevertheless, in religious silence, the men made ready to complete the solemn duty entrusted to them by Pope Pius. At 450 feet, they dropped the Italian flag, the tricolore, onto the summit of the world, followed by the flag of the city of Milan, and finally the cross that the pontiff had presented to them. And, like all crosses, the Pope had said, with a sad smile at their last audience, this one will be heavy to carry. With their jobs done, the gramophone player on the airship belted out the martial notes of the fascist party hymn, Giovinezza, Italy's unofficial national anthem of the time. With their right arms raised in the fascist salute, the crew sang along heartily under the watchful eyes of a journalist from Mussolini's own newspaper. The singing rapidly gave way to the cry of Viva Nobile and a toast of eggnog. Few men in the world can say, as we can, that they have twice been to the North Pole, said Finn Malmgren, the ship's weatherman and one of two non-Italians on the crew, to Nobile. In fact, 7 men could say they had been twice to the North Pole. These were the men who, like Nobile, had flown on the Norge and then on the Italia. Now, though, on their return journey, the joy was gone for good, in its stead a growing sense of dread. The ice seemed to be getting closer and closer, and only one man on the expedition had any experience on how to survive in the frozen wasteland below, the Swede Malmgren. Nobile had not appointed a second in command because he needed to make swift decisions in an emergency, and he believed that another pilot would slow this process down. Now, exhausted, his brain was stuck in slow motion just when events were speeding up. He was so tired that he was hallucinating. In the picture that hung on the wall of the cabin, his daughter, Maria, now looked as though she were crying. He had to tell himself that it was just the condensation on the inside of the glass. "All engines full speed," Nobile cried as he became aware of the danger they were in. The sea ice was now very close. "Climb, climb, climb." His only hope was that the increased power would pull the giant airship out of its dive. But it was too late. Looking out of the porthole, he saw that the tail of the great ship was only a few yards from the ice, 500 miles from any hope of rescue.
"It's all over,"
Nobile whispered to himself as he felt his limbs snap. The great ship smashed tail first onto the ice. 1. You are supposed to be dead. The great polar explorer, Roald Amundsen, stood by himself on the frozen Arctic shore, staring into the distance. He was 53 years old, but looked 75, and bankrupt. On the ice in front of him, the men of the Amundsen-Ellsworth polar flight had broken open the large, long wooden crates that contained the two flying boats. Now their job was to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.